Hello, everyone. Welcome to Critical Race Conversations, a series hosted by the Folger Institute. Today's session is associated with BFT, the Institute's inaugural collaborative research project Before Farm to Table, Early Modern Foodways and Cultures, funded by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. This series of conversations is also funded by that project as part of a wider exploration of important topics worthy of collaborative attention. I'm Amanda Herbert, Associate Director for Fellowships at the Folger Institute. We are delighted to gather so many friends, old and new, for these conversations. I would like to take a moment to introduce the series and our session leaders for today's event. This series of free online sessions features scholars who are offering new insights into the prehistory of modern racialized thinking and racism. Our speakers are acknowledging deeper and more complex roots to enduring social challenges and conducting more inclusive investigations of our contested pasts, all with the goal of creating a more just and more inclusive academy and society. The Institute is providing the framework and platform, but as is our practice, we turn to scholars across disciplines and career stages to lead discussions from their own experience and expertise. We recognize that we should allow others who are more knowledgeable about the field of critical race studies to create the conversations. We have much to learn. In these critical race conversations, we are actively experimenting with new technologies and new ways to foster dialogue and present content, just as so many of you are in your own classrooms and homes. In this session, our speakers welcome live tweeting with the hashtag FolgerCRC, as well as hashtag BeforeFarmToTable. You may ask questions via Twitter or on the YouTube live chat. I remind you that this session will be recorded and posted on the Folger's YouTube channel as soon as it is processed, with closed captioning enabled, and a verified transcript will be uploaded next week. Please contact the Folger Institute with any questions or concerns. Today, our session leaders will trace the intersections between food and race. They will offer an important and timely discussion that explores the ways in which food studies, critical race studies, and early modern studies inform and enrich each other. They look to modern and early modern foodways in order to examine different forms of what bell hooks has famously called eating the other. Interrogating the blurred criteria of what marks matter as edible or inedible, digestible or indigestible, Shahani and Park explore the range of substances, as well as the bodies themselves, that stand in for or comprise a culture's racial others in order to trouble the racialized assumptions complicit in the dietary commonplace that you are what you eat. Let me now briefly introduce our two presenters. Dr. Jennifer Park is assistant professor of English, specializing in early modern drama at the University of North Carolina at Greensboro. She was a 2019 research fellow with the Before Farm to Table project at the Folger Shakespeare Library. Emerging from her work on the intersections of literature, science, and medicine, race, gender, and performance in early modern England, her most recent publications focus on early modern recipe culture, including an article in Studies in Philology on candying, food preservation processes, and race in Antony and Cleopatra, an article in Performance Matters on gender, glass vessels, and alchemical performance, and an essay in the volume Food and Literature, edited by Gitanjali Shahani, on blood drinking as a form of strange eating. Professor Park is currently working on a book-length project on early modern recipes, science and medicine, and race in the plays of Shakespeare and his contemporaries. Dr. Gitanjali Shahani is a professor of English at San Francisco State University, where she teaches courses on Shakespeare studies, post-colonial studies, and food studies. She is the author of the phenomenal book, Tasting Difference: Food, Race, and Cultural Encounters in Early Modern Literature. She has edited two collections, Food and Literature, and with Brenda Cherry, Emissaries in Early Modern Literature and Culture. Her articles on race and colonialism in early modern literature have been published in numerous collections and journals, including Shakespeare, Shakespeare Studies, and the Journal of Early Modern Cultural Studies. Without further ado, I give you We Are What You Eat, Conversations on Food and Race.
Thank you so much, Amanda, and thank you to everyone at the Folger who I know has been working so hard behind the scenes to facilitate this conversation. It really is a pleasure and a privilege to be a part of the Critical Race Conversation series. Also a big hello to everyone out there in our virtual audience. Thank you all for joining us. We're really looking forward to hearing from you during the Q&A. Jennifer, it's good to see you. We've been mapping our coordinates in food studies, in critical race studies, and in early modern studies for what feels like the better part of a decade now. So I'm really excited to be revisiting these conversations with you in this context here today.
Yeah, Gitanjali, it's been so lovely to get a chance to collaborate with you again and to continue these conversations. And I want to echo your thanks to Amanda, Owen, Justine, Ben, the Before Farm to Table team at the Folger, as well as everyone involved with organizing this incredibly important series, which we're so honored to be a part of. I'm excited to have this conversation on food and race with you, Gitanjali, and especially delighted that your book has just come out with Cornell Press. I have it here, Tasting Difference, Food, Race, and Cultural Encounters in Early Modern Literature, which makes this conversation all the more timely. So to start, I was struck by your framing of the we, who are subjects who think and write on food and race, which was channeled in our discussion about what our title should be. We decided on We Are What You Eat, and I'll hand it over to you to say a little bit more about where that came from and how we might unpack that.
Thanks. Jennifer, you are the best publicist, but thank you. Yeah, we should speak about our title. That's a good place to start. What we're referring to here is obviously a tongue-in-cheek inversion of a very popular maxim, we are what you eat. It's such a cliche because you see it everywhere. You see it in advertisements, you see it in popular diet books. I've even seen it in elementary school notice boards. But what I find is that cliches, especially food cliches, are really so ripe for exploration.
I see what you did there.
because they are ripe for exploration because they tell us a lot about how our language relies on food for different forms of expression. Elizabeth Probyn, who is a scholar in food studies and queer theory, she says that food cliches are like sugar-coated versions of complex ideas. They go down easily and then they become truisms. So what are the complex ideas behind we are what we eat? What does the cliche really mean? It bears clarification that the cliche itself is actually a misquotation of the 18th century gastronome Briat Savarin, who said, "Tell me what you eat and I will tell you what you are." And somehow a watered down version of that became we are what we eat. But the misquotation aside, I think it is in the testing of the cliche that we see a starting point for so much work in food studies. Are we what we eat, or do we eat what we are? Do I eat curry because I am from India? Or is it in my eating, my serving, my cooking of curry that somehow my Indianness is authenticated? Equally, we are the when we eat, the where we eat, the how we eat. Our local and global relations to food systems tell us so much about the where we eat, the geographical points. Our historical moment tells us so much about the when of the eating. The pandemic is a really good example of that. Our commensal rituals, how we eat, do we eat in front of a TV? Do we eat together? Do we eat with our hands? That tells us so much about the how of our eating. And these questions all complicate the simple truism to become an important point of entry in food studies. For me, the inversion was the starting point. I wanted to complicate the simple inversion with the simple truism with we are what you eat, with the we being important there. It's a short and sort of pithy phrase, I hope, for me, it tells a very long and violent story of food and people and how they come together. And that's what I explore throughout my work. I'm curious how that resonated with you, how you see the we are what you eat and how you explore that in your work.
Right, absolutely. I think I want to begin with how I love that you've identified that it's in the testing and the rewriting of the food cliche that creates these spaces for complicating what we might think of as more palatable food histories and narratives. And I'm struck by how thinking through the inversion, we are what you eat, and that very trope of who or what gets eaten, who or what does the eating, engages in such visceral ways with phenomena related to racial dynamics and racial displacement. So I'm thinking about processes and terms like incorporation, assimilation, bringing into a cultural or political or social body, And I'm also thinking about the way that that violence that you mentioned, that's inherent in the mantra and in its version, it evokes the violence of erasures too. So ingestion, digestion, disillusion as these violent erasures in a certain sense. And this makes me think about what kinds of traces remain in the face of those ingestions that we can look to recuperate some of those histories.
Yeah, so many writers have sought to recuperate these erasures. You know, Stuart Hall comes to mind. He puts it beautifully when he reminds us, I am the sugar at the bottom of the English cup of tea. I am the tea itself. The histories of sugar, of the tea, of the pepper, of the coffee that everyone's probably drinking right now. These are histories of migration, of plantation, of transplantation, of colonialism, essentially our histories. You know, the simple act of what in the UK is called going out for an Indian is an act that involves a long and complicated history for every Indian or South Asian more generally. And the question I was trying to ask in my work related to these histories were, you know, how do we as racial subjects become edible objects? How do we, conversely, how do edible objects come to bear the marks of race? And Jennifer, you and I know something about this, right? You know, how often are Asian and Asian American identities made palatable through food? People relate to us by telling us about their favorite Indian takeout place.
Right, exactly. Or Korean barbecue, for example.
Korean barbecue, exactly. People read our literature if it has food on the cover, frequently when it has nothing to do with food. There is much work in Asian American studies as well on how we ourselves are complicit in making our identities more palatable and assimilating via food, and equally how our food, how our tastes, how our smells mark us as different. And in my work, I was trying to look at how this sense of difference is experienced at an elementary level. How is racial and religious difference experienced as a gut response, if you will? And this is where our early modern sources are so fascinating, because long before the average English household had encountered an Indian, and whether you take that to be the meal now or the person, it had encountered nutmeg and pepper in pies and in possets and in contraceptives and in morning after treatments. And in this sense, you know, what Shakespeare calls the spiced Indian air, had made its way into England's collection, into England's recipe collections and imaginative writing long before any large-scale migrant movement.
Right, exactly. And likewise, the English housewife in the 17th century had no direct contact with the enslaved peoples of the Caribbean plantation, but she would sprinkle the products of their labor into her cordials and would taste their sugar in her sweetmeats and her confections.
Yeah, I think what we're saying here is that the culinary realm is one that registers encounters with difference on an unprecedented scale. So having said that, and having talked a lot about our title and the idea of tasting difference, I just wonder if we might say something about our methods, because we've talked about the fact that we've worked so often and for so long in critical race studies and in early modern studies and in food studies. So maybe let's map those out.
Yeah, absolutely. I do want to get a start with how I love in your work, how you've looked at how difference is experienced at an elementary level and how you've conceptualized this as the taste of difference. And so the racialized subject or body as the edible object and vice versa has been integral to my thinking about food and race. And it makes me think of how critical race studies and specifically pre-modern critical race studies offer such productive interventions for me and my approach to the work that I do with food and recipes. So I'm so grateful, for example, for Margot Hendricks and what she so powerfully termed pre-modern critical race studies in her talk at the Folger Shakespeare Library in fall of 2019, and bringing attention to how it must acknowledge the scholarly ancestry or the genealogy that contributes to inhabit that continues to inhabit and nurture the critical process for the study of pre-modern race. And for me, this is where I'm indebted to the incredibly generative work of scholars who are bringing attention to exactly that. So thinking through the critical genealogy of the study of race and considering food studies and all of its interdisciplinary reaches, particularly significant for me in the sphere has been Keela Tompkins's work on racial indigestion and eating bodies in the 19th century. And her attention to the ways that racially minoritized subjects and bodies are often portrayed or conceptualized as hyper-embodied when we consider the history of whiteness in eating culture. I'm also thinking about Kim Hall's foundational critical race work and her wonderful essays on gender and sugar and on Thomas Tryon. And most recently, of course, I've been thrilled about your book. I've also been interested in pursuing questions of embodiment and materiality in my work. So, you know, in thinking about how those processes of ingestion, incorporation, assimilation might work, I've been inspired by other pre-modern critical race work, like Patricia Akimi's brilliant work on somatic markers and the cultivation of the body or self, which has generative resonances also with the idea of the cultivation of the land. And so both of those things are so integrally connected to foodways. And I'm, of course, indebted to her articulation of the structures that amplify race making, which has been so helpful for locating and interrogating how race is structurally embedded in early modern food and recipe cultures.
Yeah, I think if I had to sum up what you're saying, I'd put it in a way that I'd say that we have to be necessarily omnivorous in our methods, in what we're doing. I mean, you know, you've clearly articulated how much our work is founded in pre-modern critical race studies. It's not without coincidence that we're having this conversation in the 25th anniversary year of Kim Hall's Things of Darkness. As you pointed out, her work on sugar shapes so much of the work we do on food and race, in my case, with spices, in your case, also with sugar. I think we're also so indebted to early work in food studies. You know, so many of those scholars did the hard work of dispelling anxieties associated with putting together or putting something as seemingly superficial as food at the center of critical analysis. You know, Keela Tompkins, whom you already mentioned, does a lot of that. Anita Manur does that. I think they facilitated for us a place at the table, especially in terms of looking at how otherness is consumed and produced in relation to works on food. I've found, in addition, that work on early modern cross-cultural encounters, you know, some of Anya Lumba's early work, Jyotsna Singh's work on the global early modern, that has really shaped what, throughout my work, I call the culinary contact zone, and it's been a productive way of looking at encounters during the period. There's also, you know, it's productive for me to draw on paradigms in post-colonial studies. So especially work on encounters that are attuned to the alimentary nature of these cross-cultural encounters. You know, I think of the process of procuring food, the process of transporting food, of consuming it, of cooking it. So much work in post-colonial studies that is impelled by foodstuff looks at this. I'm also thinking of Parama Roy's work in particular. And you have the show and tell ready. That's perfect. It's a beautiful cover. So yeah, Parama Roy's work where she says, what if we take Marx's image of vampire capitalism and harness it to a kind of cannibal colonialism? You know, what if we were to think of colonialism as this greedy mouth that feeds off the teas, the coffees, the opium, the drugs of empire? What if we think of what she calls the psychopharmacopoeia of empire? So this work in post-colonial studies as well is useful to us. And these are all very useful points of convergence for us as we examine the literary and material texts about food. So, you know, having said that, maybe we can move on to some of the foods itself.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. So, and it's been so generative to think about the, or think across the wonderful work of all of these scholars in our methods. And so we'll be segueing into how we apply those methods to looking at particular foodstuffs. We'll be taking a look at some original sources and foods and ingredients to again, think about how it is that we do work in food and race.
Right. Looking at the actual ingredients, if you will. I'm obviously partial to this beautiful engraving. There is a reason it made it to my cover, so it's a good place for me to start here. I think this image captures, in a nutshell, what we've been arguing about so many of the foods here. You can see it appears in Sylvester Durfer's late 17th century treatise on coffee, tea, and chocolate. It circulated in numerous editions and translations throughout the period, really. And it gives us a good example of how foods get racialized in terms of their points of origin and how racialized bodies become objects to be consumed as food. You can see when you look at it closely how it depicts each drink in the hands of the figure that supposedly best personifies it. So we have a turbaned Turk figure holding a bowl of coffee. An ornately dressed Asian man in the middle holds a vessel with tea. And then there's the figure of the Native American in the feathered headdress holding a pot of chocolate. You can see each man is positioned near the appropriate container. There's a curved coffee pot right beside the figure of the Turk. There's a spouted teapot right beside the Asian man. And then there's a tall chocolate pot with a stirrer right by the Native American man. And when you think about it, on display here are the men rather than the beverages they drink. In fact, the beverages themselves seem indistinguishable, but for the containers in which they're stored. All three men are depicted in an act of consumption, but they are equally figures to be consumed by the reader. The coffee, the tea, the chocolate of the title are presented as incarnate forms, even as they are presented as edible commodities. In a sense, they are what you eat or drink, as the case might be. So that felt like a good starting point for a lot of the foods that we're going to be talking about.
Right. And going from the previous engraving that Gitanjali was just explaining to us, what we see here is how bodies that are marked as foreign from the previous engraving kind of continue, that trope continues to our present day. So what viewers would mark here as racially diverse bodies that have been drenched in honey that are colonized and preserved here in these images by photographer Blake Little. And what this also brings up is, the question of what it means for, in this case, a white cis male artist to depict other figures as potentially edible in this way. And I wanted to use this image to talk a little bit about my first moment in thinking about food and race by way of food preservation. It's interesting to see the ways that these foodstuffs are being worked with, both literally and metaphorically. And so my, kind of key moment goes back to Shakespeare and his description in Antony and Cleopatra of salt Cleopatra, and thinking about salt as a descriptor for his representation of the Egyptian queen, and having that refer to salted meat, which would have been preserved for longer, and according to some, more flavorful. And that's when I noticed other descriptors popping out. So references to Cleopatra as an Egyptian dish being fed upon by Caesar with sexual implications. Of course, exactly what bell hooks outlines as the concept of eating the other. Shakespeare was also developing new terms inspired by food in the play. So for example, both Cleopatra and Antony use the term discandy, which was Shakespeare's way of playing with a process of preserving fruits and flowers with sugar, a process that was called candying. And it's a fascinating problematic concept to think through sugar, how it's used, how it signifies in early modern England. And Kim Hall notes that English women's uses of sugar in recipes for preserving was a way of contributing to England's colonial expansion in the period, and how sugar is a product associated both with white women and with African slavery. And in light of this, I'm thinking about the complex questions that it raises, what it means for early modern English women to use this imported foreign ingredient with a violent history to preserve, for example, local fruits and flowers. And then alternatively, to think about what it also meant for Shakespeare to imagine Cleopatra as a preserved food item, how the early modern English are looking to preserve or to assimilate foreign ingredients as preservatives, and even to visualize, again, in our present day, as we see here in these images, the body candied over, these racialized bodies that are preserved by way of foodstuffs. And this idea of preservation is something that's interesting with regard to spices.
Yeah, you're so right in noting this point about preservation with spices, because I think, you know, it's often been said that we've heard almost as a kind of received wisdom, the fact that spices were sought after because of their ability to preserve food, especially spoiling meat. But historians like Peter Friedman have debunked this myth. In fact, many historians have. They argue that spices do little in this regard compared with, say, salting or smoking or pickling. Rather, spices are sought after precisely for their mysterious origins, their efficacy as medicines and cosmetics, and their association with sophisticated cuisines. And I think it's interesting to note that it is these appetites rather than a simple necessity that propel European expansion in ways that fundamentally transform world history. And going to our next slide, we can see examples of the many uses to which spices are put, none of them involving preservation, actually. This is just one of many thousands of possible examples I could have included here. It's from Mistress Sarah Long's receipt book. The manuscript is from the early 1600s, and it is housed at the Folger, I believe. It reveals a range of household responsibilities that fell to the English housewife in the realm of the culinary and the curated. I've only included one image here from the manuscript, just so you can see her hand, but you can see the others as they're transcribed, so you can see the spices referenced more clearly here. And it appears that Sarah Long uses spices for all kinds of things. She uses mace in her gooseberry fool. She uses cloves, mace, and nutmeg in a posset. She also uses spices for very intimate bodily practices. If you look at the one that says a remedy for such as are subject to miscarry, here she sprinkles an ounce of nutmeg and a mix of cinnamon and sugar in another to treat women who are dealing with a miscarriage. And like Long, other 17th century women relied on a steady supply of spices from the East for the most intimate practices. One manual from the 1650s suggests that they used pepper in what they called the natural place after they had known a man carnally in order to hinder conception. Another recipe from Hannah Woolley's noted work looks at the use of pepper to what she calls provoke the terms in order to bring on the menstrual cycle. Some scholars think that these are coded abortion recipes. So spices could also, in addition to these very intimate uses, they could have also been used for various cosmetic purposes. Hannah Woolley made sure to include them in a potion that promised to make the hair fair, in a sweet water for the hands, and in what she called the queen's perfume, the last of which required no less than 30 cloves.
Wow. Right. So given that spices were foreign ingredients, what do you make of the physiological proximity to these spices? Was there any backlash or response to using spices in this way?
Yeah, it's interesting that you bring up backlash and the fact that it takes on such a strong racial dimension. One of the most vehement responses comes from a writer called Thomas Tryon, and you can see it up here. Tryon, like some other writers of domestic manuals and medical treatises, is especially concerned with the English housewife's proclivity to use spices from the East in what he calls our domestic productions. He's preoccupied with the idea that these spices, coming as they do from India or the East more generally, have the ability to transform the English physiognomy by mixing English staples with the products of what he calls blackamoors and bantermen. He's really referring to the Javanese islanders here. The English housewife, he feels, was in essence committing a grossly unnatural act. And if you look at the image I have here from his text, you can see how preoccupied with he is with this idea of agreement or affinity or likeness. That's what he sees being disrupted by the use of spices. I'll just read it out for its full effect. What agreement or affinity is there between our fruits, grains, herbs, and seeds and those that come from the East and West Indies? And he's going to go on and answer that question himself. Not so much as between the complexion of a fat-nosed, lubber-lipped blackamoor or a swarthy bantaman with a head like a sugar loaf and our most florid beauties. He then goes on to conjure up an image of the monstrous hybrid creature that will be created from this mingling, what he calls this monstrous mingling of English staples with foreign ingredients. Before we move on from spices, I want to briefly note that what's so interesting about spices is their simultaneous appearance in works like this, in the realm of the everyday, in the mundane and the practical that we saw with Sarah Long, even as they're so much a part of the imaginative literature on the East. It's not for nothing that Shakespeare's version of Fairyland in A Midsummer Night's Dream takes place in the spiced Indian air, right? The entire fairy subplot hinges on the figure of the Indian boy and the memory of the Indian votaress, neither of whom necessarily appears in the play. They both exist in the spiced Indian air, where Titania recalls consuming trifles that the Indian votaress brings her very lovingly. I like to think of the conflict in Fairyland as something like the conflict we're seeing here between women like Sarah Long and their use of spices, and men like Tryon's disapproval of these uses. And somehow the Indian boy could be seen as an embodiment of that discord, an embodiment of that taste of difference that somehow comes about with regard to spices.
Right, and I love what you were saying about the spiced Indian air, right? And this idea that it becomes, that both the Indian boy and the Indian votaress exist in that space. And we've talked a little bit about sugar and spices in this regard as these foreign ingredients being used. But there's also something to be said about how ideas about fluidity and foreign fluids also circulated during this time. And so to begin with, the early modern body was already thought to be porous and fluid, governed by fluids in the form of the four humors, and thus affected by and affecting both the environment as well as other bodies. And I think here about how that fluid state was often perceived as a threat, as a danger. And I want to think about that alongside this meditation that post-colonialist and decolonialist Julietta Singh offers here, that, and I quote, "In the end, we are not bounded, contained subjects, but ones filled up with foreign feelings and vibes that linger and circulate in space, that enter us as we move through our lives. We likewise leave traces of ourselves and our own affective states, which are never really just our own, behind us when we go." And so for me, in thinking about the fluid body in relation to food and race, it's interesting that not only did these foreign ingredients have the potential to linger and transform the body, but the body's own fluids themselves, and I'm thinking here specifically about blood and breast milk, were thought to be an infant's and a child's first nourishment. And they were also racially charged bodily fluids, prompting contention about the use of wet nurses, for example. And these were also fluids that were used as ingredients in recipes. You might see a recipe call for blood or call for a woman's breast milk, for example. And the challenges that fluids present to thinking about food and race become further marked later in the 17th century when we start seeing the popularity of other foreign fluids like tea, chocolate, and coffee that became the rage in early modern Europe.
Yeah, I want to move to coffee, but I just want to add that blood, breast milk, I've also seen urine used. So fluids right. Really complicate the idea of foods. But as we transition from looking at foods to drinks and fluids, we're also moving from the curative and the preservative to a stimulant, especially with regard to coffee. As with spices, you can see how there's a clear exoticization of coffee as well. This was already apparent when we looked at the Darfur image a few slides ago. We saw the Turban Turk consuming coffee. And in fact, by the end of the 17th century, some historians estimate that there were about 37 London coffee houses that were called the Turk's Head. It's a very specific number, but it should tell you that there were 37 coffee houses called the Turk's Head, and many used that same symbol as their identifying mark about their entrance and also on their trade tokens. By the end of the century, we see how this takes on an even more exotic dimension, and coffee becomes part of the visual appeal of the coffee service. This is a much later image. It's from Carl Van Loo's portrait of Madame Pompadour from the 1750s. And you can see the exotic appeal of both the coffee service and the server herself here. But before we get to this point, there is the same anxiety about coffee's otherness and its racial difference and its fluidity within this difference, like we see with spices. In its earliest incarnations in 17th century England, it was variously described in ballads and broadsides as a Mohammedan gruel, an ugly Turkish enchantress, a bold Asian brat, a Jew, an infidel. And these are all affiliations that variously derive from coffee's supposed origins in Ethiopia, its popularity throughout Ottoman and Mughal territories, and its supposed introduction into English social life via Jewish purveyors. It's interesting to see how this racialization of coffee generally attaches itself to the Turk and the Moor, and in one instance quite specifically attaches itself to Othello. There's a 1672 broadside against coffee. It's also called the Marriage of the Turk, which claimed that coffee is like Shakespeare's Moor, contaminating the pure as water Desdemona. It then offers us a recipe for coffee where it follows the Othello plot closely. So coffee and water, Othello and Desdemona, are first brought together with a great stir. He's beaten into a union and she's distilled into it. Of course, she's overcome and taken over by the Moor, which refers to the process by which water fully takes on the flavor of coffee. And by the end of the ballad, the Moor, who is now referred to as a Turk, destroys her entirely. What I find so troubling is how this affiliation between coffee, tea, chocolate, and Othello continues to live on in the present. These are just two images of that, but there were so many examples I came across that I, you know, couldn't possibly reproduce them here. There are brand name Othello teas. There is a well-known dessert cake called the Othello layer cake that you're seeing here. It's special occasions. There are particular seasonal Othello coffees sold just in my neighborhood. I know the Castro used to have, I live in San Francisco, the Castro used to have an Othello cookie that was very famous for a long time. So it seems like of all Shakespeare's tragic heroes, Othello appears to have the most persistent afterlife in food and drink. And it's not without coincidence that has to do with his racialized body.
Yeah, it's really striking to me, Gitanjali, what you've mentioned in terms of Othello's afterlives in food and drink, which speaks so powerfully to that conflation of the racial subject as edible object. And it makes me think of how that concept was literalized in pre-modern and early modern Europe as well. And so here we have, so the term mummy that we often use to refer to anciently embalmed Egyptian bodies initially referred to a medicinal substance that was derived from corpses during this period. You might find reference to mummy as an ingredient in various recipes for elixirs, balms, skin treatments, and it was sanctioned as a form of medicinal cannibalism in early modern Europe. But what's crucial to understand about mummy was that in the texts of the period, mummy was specifically meant to be made from the embalmed bodies that were being taken from the Middle East and Africa and were imported into Europe in order to be made into medicine for European consumers. And a big question for me has been, you know, what to make of the fact that these bodies that are being marked as foreign are literally being consumed, being reduced to a medicinal ingredient, even represented in catalogs of ingredients and herbals like that pictured here. So the presumably othered body as mummy, and this is what we see in the middle, is being listed alongside ingredients and plants like mint on the left and the mandrake on the right, as you can see here. And so it really does bring up this question of, you know, what did it mean to derive an ingredient from the foreign body itself?
Wow, your work on mummy, Jennifer, is so fascinating. There's just one final point I want to make about mummy before we move on. And I think this is just something that I want to put out here because it recalls our earlier discussion of the ways in which, you know, what we're discussing here, it is such a violent history. We talked about this in our opening remarks, but I think this recipe for mummy really brings that out. And I reproduce it here, but I won't read it. It's anthologized in Samuel Perkis's Pilgrimage. But it tells us how the Moor is decapitated and how the fluids are extracted. Received wisdom regarding mummy suggests that its efficacy depended on the violence inherent in its procurement. procurement. Even if this is a form of exaggeration, its violence on the racialized body is apparent. The idea that this was circulating as a recipe for procuring substances is just something I want us to keep in mind, so that we remember that the process of getting these ingredients is just so violent. And maybe we can turn away from it, having kept that in mind. So as you know, we are we're drawing to a close. I want us to think about some of the things we've seen along the way. We've seen so many forms of racialized body, whether in relation to coffee or tea or chocolate, you know, the fluids and the liquids, whether in relation to spices and sugar or in relation to mummy. We've also seen it in so many realms. We've seen it in the realm of the culinary, the curative, and the cosmetic. We've also seen it in so many genres. We see it in the imaginative literature of the period, in recipe collections, in dietaries, in household manuals, in ballads and broadsides. So it's not just, you know, the many genres, it's the many realms, it's the many forms. There's such an affective range associated with this racialization as well. There's fear and desire, there's appetite and aversion, there's sweetness and bitterness. And as we near the end of what we've been discussing, I think we must also contemplate the afterlives of these days. Stacks. What lives on in our foodways is shaped profoundly by these encounters. How do we continue to consume difference? The Othello coffee lives on, as we just saw, but what are the other more subtle ways in which we continue to consume the other in daily routine and more mundane acts of consumption, really?
Right, absolutely. And so what we've tried to do here is to share but a fraction of the wide range of critical approaches to thinking across food and race. And I'm also really excited about the potential and the future directions for the field. I think there's so much space to think about these intersections of food and race in ongoing recipe studies, in science studies, environmental and eco studies. And I think one of the most important of these is thinking about the intersections of critical indigenous studies and in food studies. So, you know, with people like Liz Hoover, who has been working on reclaiming food sovereignty in Native communities, and what she has called the indigenizing of the local food movement, and Sean Sherman, who is working with Indigenous education and developing Indigenous kitchens, which is such necessary and important work.
Yeah, I think, these are all valid points, and I think we should close here so that we have some time for questions. I can imagine there will be questions about particular foods that we've discussed. There might be questions about the methods we've used, or there might be questions about, you know, the title that we spent so much time explicating. But before we wrap up, I want to say one quick thing by way of reflection of this discussion that we've had. I'm being only partly facetious when I say that, what we've given our audience here is really like a recipe. We've offered ingredients we work with, and we've offered methods for how you can bring them together. But as with any recipe, I can speak for both you and me, Jennifer, that in what the audience takes away from here, in what you take away from here, you will likely improvise, you will adapt, you will season to taste. And what both of us are really looking forward to are the many new incarnations that we hope will come from what you take away from here. So thank you so much. And we now look forward to questions.
Yeah, thank you so much. So it does look like we have some questions coming in. And our first question is sort of speaking to recipe adaptation, interpretation and cooking as popular activities in many early modern food studies classrooms today. Is that activity problematized in a critical race studies or food studies classroom?
Yeah, that's... that is interesting. And I think that, you know, there's so, in pedagogical terms, there's so much to be gained from the process of looking at recipes, you know, situating recipes as a narrative, revisiting those and looking at the narrative arguments that are at work in a recipe. I think some of, it was maybe, I want to say now 30 years ago that Susan Lenardi started, started this article by giving us a recipe. It was an article in PMLA. And then what she did was, in her process of sharing, what she looked at is how she had legitimized the recipe as a genre as well. So there is a lot that is productive in looking at that recipe, looking at it in that form. What I am conscious of in critical race studies and what we do in the classroom is that effort cannot just simply be an antiquarian effort to sort of play Betty Crocker in the classroom. There is a way in which we need to have the very conversations we had about these foods, about the products, about the violence of their procurement. I think Robert Applebaum has an interesting phrase where he says, we need not to be time traveling tourists in looking at the foodways of the past. That's not all that we're doing. And that's why connecting them to the present and looking at their racial histories, I think, is also valuable in the classroom.
Right. I absolutely agree. And, particularly because these, some of these food narratives or histories that we might have inherited are much more problematic than we might have been told. And so I do think that, that actually things like maybe recipe adaptation, interpretation, and cooking, as sort of popular activities in the food studies classroom can actually be really rich sites for recovering some of the problematic ideas there, right? So, whether it's looking at particular ingredients and their histories and, the histories of violence that are kind of involved in procuring those ingredients, or even, if we think about, recipe transmission and the kinds of erasures that also occur, so often recipes were kind of seen as these communal documents, these communal texts, and so recipes kind of complicate the idea of authorship. But in doing so, I think there are ways that that other kinds of citational practices sort of fall in the cracks. There are some examples of that. Hugh Platt in one of the recipes that he kind of gives to the reader, mentions that it came from, some outlandish woman. And so this idea of a foreign woman that, that he got this recipe from, but of course she's not named. And, it's in passing in the middle of the recipe before he goes on to say, what you kind of need to do. I think absolutely these activities are problematized in a critical race studies, food studies classroom, but in ways that are really generative. And I think kind of bring up a lot of different things.
Absolutely. We can't pass those moments by. I see there's another question here about bodily fluids. Do you want to read it for?
Sure. Yeah. This particular questioner would like to know more about the recipes that call for bodily fluids. So what were they for? Would they be more or less accessible or efficacious if you couldn't use your own body to supply the ingredients? That's a good question.
Yeah, I think the recipes are so specific in this regard. There's one that comes to mind where they're used for a range of things. They're used for, children prone to bedwetting. There's one that calls for urine and the urine of a boy child. I think it's a Hannah Woolley recipe where it calls for the urine of a boy child in order to be put on a feather, which when put on the eyes can apparently cure blindness. So they're there as cures for blindness. They're there as cures, in fact, for bedwetting. They're very medicinal in the way that they're used, but they're also quite specific. One of them says that if you need to cure something in a boy child, then use the urine of a girl. If you need to cure something in, the girl, use the urine of a boy. So it's quite particular about those sources. There's another one that asks us to powder the skulls that are taken from graves. It even suggests preferably, I think, criminal or Irish skulls that if pounded up can be used in, that's not a fluid, but it's what I'm trying to say is it's very specific in what it's asking you to get as the source for that matter.
Right, absolutely. Yeah, because I think that the idea of bodily fluids as an ingredient in these recipes is very much in line with this kind of idea of sanctioned medicinal cannibalism, right? So the body, the human body as a source for ingredients. And you're absolutely right. I feel like in the recipes that I've seen for this, you know, it does seem to, or a lot of recipes that call for maybe, you know, blood or urine or, you know, milk or so many of them are very specific about the kind of body, right? Whether it, you know, whether it has to do with something like age. So, you know, I've seen a recipe that called specifically for the blood of a child, you know, or I think, you know, I believe Gitanjali, you and I have talked about this, you know, this a recipe where, you know, the ingredient is mummy, but specifically from somebody who's maybe, you know, died a violent death or something, you know, or kind of a young, healthy man. So this idea that that the body and, it, you know, its specific virtues are being harnessed for, you know, those ingredients. And so, you know, it is kind of interesting to look at that question about, you know, are they more or less efficacious if you couldn't use your own body? And in fact, it is kind of strange to think about how specific some of these, you know, some of these asks are, and where you would even go to get it, right? So it wasn't actually, I don't know that I necessarily saw, you know, many recipes that called for you to kind of take it from yourself, but rather it's almost like you had to kind of procure it from a particular body or a particular source. And that seems to indicate that in order for the recipe to be efficacious, you almost had to kind of go to the source of where to get that particular product.
There's another pedagogical question.
Yes. Yeah. So it looks like, you know, Gitanjali, you had mentioned the need for race and food waste scholars to be omnivorous. And I think that's when we were talking about our methods. So if you were designing a graduate or undergraduate studies program on race and food waste from scratch, which disciplines would you draw on? That's kind of exciting.
Question. I haven't had the opportunity to think of this as a program, but I have designed undergraduate and grad courses on food and lit more generally. And they've been informed by critical race studies perspectives and, you know, all of the disciplines we spoke of in an effort to be omnivorous in precisely the ways that we discussed. I think it's also in, you know, in the classroom, rather than, you know, sort of have a trajectory of my book laid out there, what I like for is different points of entry. So what I've tried to organize these around is the same troubling of the cliche, where I go from the, you know, the where we eat, the what we eat, the how we eat, the who eats whom, and it's those W questions that really organize my thinking, and then that allows me to bring in work in Asian American studies, work from food and children's literature, you know, work on the environmental humanities that is now concerned with foodways. You know, it allows me to bring a lot of well-known works, you know, sort of Michael Pollan's work and some of that more popular writing on food. So that allows me to draw on many disciplines when I'm not narrowing it down to a course on one or the other. And what's been interesting for me to see is that how the final projects that come from courses like that, many of them go on to become you know, master's theses, they really take it in directions and in texts that I'm not familiar with. I've learned so much about primary texts from the work that students bring in to the classroom as a result of it. So we're just dealing with a theoretical approach with food studies and critical race studies, with post-colonial studies and all of these other approaches I mentioned. And then you let it brew and interesting things happen.
Right, absolutely. And yeah, in terms of the, you know, the kind of range of disciplines to draw on, which, you know, it is always really fun to think about that. You know, Gitanjali, you and I had talked a little bit about how food studies is already so interdisciplinary, right? And kind of all the different ways that there are these different kind of disciplinary access points to kind of think about food and how that interdisciplinary nature kind of enriches, you know, the kinds of discussions that are done. And, you know, when I've developed, you know, a grad or undergraduate class. You know, I've not developed a program either, but you know, in terms of thinking and pedagogically, you know, I've also drawn on the history of medicine, the history of science, that I think are just you know really rich kind of sites for thinking about, you know, how the body was conceptualized, you know, so studies in the body as well and embodiment, as well as, you know, you were kind of saying environmental studies, eco studies, precisely because, you know, so much of, you know, of actually the work on food, as well as sort of you know, early ideas about race that were kind of budding in the period, were very much kind of integrated with ideas about nature and the natural order of things, of flora and fauna, as well as kind of human species. And so, you know, I find that, you know, in kind of thinking about race and foodways together, kind of pedagogically, whether it's for a course or for a program, you know, there are all of these disciplines that that really kind of help to bring up new questions and kind of make new connections between them. Mm-hmm. So it looks like we have another question. And the question is, could you talk about what is food distinctive in your methods or arguments? Do other imports from long distance trade do comparable racializing work? And so this person here is thinking of Gitanjali, your essay on Indian textiles, for example.
Yeah, they do. And, you know, there's a good reason why we see patterns. There's a good reason why we move from spices to textiles as well. It has to do with the vagaries of the East India Company and their competition with the Dutch East India Company. And they didn't have a stronghold on the subcontinent. And as a result, the spice trade sort of took a back foot for a while, and we see the trade in fabrics. So yes, those responses are also raised. But I think what would be food distinctive here with regard to you know, spices and things like that is what I call the gut response. You know, it's just so messy. It's so visceral. It has so much to do with the sense of taste, where clothing, I think, you know, it's often used as, you know, looking at markers of appearance, looking at markers of difference in those terms. Here, it's the physiological changes that foods can be seen as affecting. So we see both desire for that, and then we see both disgust at that. And that contact zone, you know, that food is able to effect takes, you see it forming in faraway lands, when you see travelers, you know, going along the Cape of Good Hope or in the Mughal court, and they're actually tasting things and they're ingesting things and their response to that. And then equally when these commodities come home, whereas with items like, you know, cloth, we don't see as much of a discussion of, you know, that messy and bodily response and that fear of ingestion that we see here. Although clothes can be seen as affecting many other markers, I think it's the gut response that would answer that for me.
I guess I'll just speak really briefly to kind of maybe what's food distinctive in methods and arguments. And I think for me, food has been a really kind of rich site to just to sort of constellate out of in a way. And so I think for me, what's been kind of central is this idea of kind of the constitution of the body and, you know, a more kind of recent, you know, theory of metabolism as, you know, as a way of thinking about the body as constantly changing and constantly needing replenishment. And so, you know, at any given point, you know, everything that's sort of making up your body is not what it was at a particular time in the past, you know, which is a little bit mind-blowing. And so I think that, you know, food plays such a big role in that precisely because that is sort of the arena of, you know, or sort of the source of what replenishes the body. And so because of that, it has such, you know, such a transformative kind of weight, right? A transformative kind of power. And for me, I think that taps into a lot of questions about, you know, not just constitution, but also about agency. And so, you know, to what extent does one have kind of, control over certain substances over your body, and to what extent does food as sort of this circulating kind of thing trouble all of those attempts to control in both kind of restrictive and also kind of liberatory ways. It looks like we have a question about hunger. This particular asker is saying, I'm curious about how both scholars think about hunger, as in food insecurity, in relation to this topic.
Yeah, had we world enough in time, you know, to think that we would have addressed hunger. I write about it a lot in the context of Jamestown, and, you know, particular episodes when apparently the Virginia Company ran out of food, and the very extreme and drastic measures that we know they had to take as a result. What I find so interesting is that in the language of hunger, or in the language that's used to describe hunger, hunger is also described as a taste, you know, or the absence of food there is, you know, it's the taste for food that could have been, and then it's the taste in the mouth and, you know, the belly that just, you know, that long for what used to be food. So there's really an effort in those narratives to describe what it means to taste what is not there. And they start off by, of course, reminiscing. I mean, we see this in imaginative literature as well. We see it in a play like The Tempest. We see it in a reworking or the remixed version of The Tempest, you know, The Sea Voyage, where they start out by talking about things that they could have had, or, you know, meals that were tasted before voyages began. And then they go to speak about that absence. You know, my belly, you know, my mouth feels like, you know, it's craving it. My belly feels like an empty satchel. And then they go on to contemplate the taste of things that they could eat that could be food substitutes. You know, in some of the narratives, it's like, you know, what would vermin taste like right now? What would animals taste like right now? And of course, you can see where this is going, because it ends up being like, what would another human being taste like right now? And there's a long narrative there about supposedly myth about a man in the colony who then powdered and ate his wife. Out of hunger, and, you know, the taste of that, like, what does it mean that he powdered your meaning seasoning? Like, what does it mean that he, you know, is the act less cannibalistic because you just, you know, you thought to season her? Is the seasoning itself, you know, somehow contemplating off that? Does that make it more cannibalistic? Some offer the rationale, oh, well, he ran out of food, so it wasn't cannibalism, it was, you know, extreme. But In all of that, I think what I find so interesting is how hunger has a taste in relation to these.
Yeah, that's actually really fascinating. And I think, and definitely hunger is something that's a really kind of powerful concept. And it was something that I've been learning a little bit more about, especially, you know, with some really wonderful speakers and scholars at, you know, the recent Food and the Book conference, you know, with the Newberry Library, and also with the Before Farm to Table project at the Folger. And, you know, it's definitely been making me think about, you know, the ways that I need to kind of address that more in my work, right? So, you know, what does it mean to kind of think about hunger and food insecurity in relation to food and race? And I think right now, as I'm kind of thinking, you know, a really kind of generative site for me is kind of thinking about, also this was a session, you know, for the Food in the Book conference on Indigenous foodways. And, you know, it was just so kind of striking to learn about the ways that, you know, the kind of study of kind of critical Indigenous studies and food studies, you know, converging to kind of not just recover certain histories that have been erased or overlooked, but applying that knowledge and, you know, what the speakers were also, you know, talking about in terms of Indigenous knowledge, bringing that into the present in order to think about contemporary issues of hunger and food insecurity. And so I think that's sort of what, you know, where I'm thinking about that question right now as again, a really kind of powerful and urgent site, and something that I'm kind of hoping to learn from as well, to kind of, you know, move into the future with this kind of work. So it looks like, it looks like we have a question that's actually maybe related to what you said about the powdered wife. Basically, how is mummy related to or connected to discourses on New World cannibalism?
I have, and you know more about mummy than I do, but
I don't know about that.
I haven't seen those bodies being, or those acts of cannibalism in taking that substance and putting it to other uses. We do see mummy, being procured from other places, as salves, as bombs. Here, we don't see that. We just don't see that in the New World context. And I'm really not sure why that is. I think it has to do with transportation as well. I don't know if you have any insights on that.
Right. No, yeah. And I think, I think I've always, not always, but ever since, I've been kind of researching mummy and some of this kind of sanctioned medicinal cannibalism. I think what's been striking to me about looking at that is, or what resonates for me is the sort of implicit hypocrisy, right, of the early modern Europeans consuming, kind of partaking in cannibalism in these ways, while, also kind of producing these ideologies and texts that are condemning New World cannibalism as something that, that they're distant from. And so I think that's where for me there's been some kind of interest in what those ideological kind of differences are, how the early modern Europeans or the early modern English are kind of thinking through what those differences are. And I feel like I read somewhere one theory of why mummy was okay. I don't remember what the reference was. So also if anybody in the audience does know this, but it was a theory that because the bodies that were, again, constituting mummy were from pagan bodies. And so kind of non-Christian bodies, that this sort of made it okay for the Europeans to consume. And I wonder, how that might also be in dialogue with, it certainly kind of complexifies, ideas of food and race in relation to eating your fellow humans, right? And to what extent you're kind of considering them humans. And so, I wonder if there's something there in trying to parse out, the mummy practice and then kind of New World cannibalism and the kind of condemning practices there.
It looks like we have time for one last question, Chris.
Okay, yes, and it looks like we have one. So would you share any reflections on dietary choices and or restrictions? So for example, vegetable-based eating, religious dictates about unhealthy or forbidden foods, et cetera, and their resonances in the period.
Yeah, I think, one of the figures that sticks out is interestingly Thomas Tryon. The word vegetarian is almost an anachronism to describe eating ways or food ways of someone during this time. But that is essentially what he lives on in so much work for advocating for not eating anything procured through a kind of violence. In fact, it is supposed that Tryon's writing on not eating meat and not eating anything through violence is supposed to have influenced, I believe, Benjamin Franklin and Alpha Ben, and via them, some people say even the Mahatma Gandhi. So I'm not sure about that last bit, but I think what we're seeing here is that, his objection to sugar especially, is in many ways coming from that idea that when you are eating something that is premised on an entire system of exploiting the body of enslaved peoples, then you are eating and consuming something that is inherently violent. So we see restrictions on diet there. But I think he did try to proselytize these ways, but I know that at least in his biography, it says that he says at some point that he did not have any success in convincing his wife, Susanna, to turn to his ways. He was starting to think in terms of asking others to convert to what we now call vegetarianism.
Right. And I'm kind of curious about the or kind of thinking with regard to this question about the unhealthy or forbidden foods. And I think, you know, I'm thinking of things like and I feel like I learned so much even again, kind of with other scholars working on, you know, religious foods and, you know, forbidden foods in terms of, you know, religious ideology and religious practices. As well as sort of, you know, certain ideas about, you know, things like, you know, fruits being, you know, something that you shouldn't consume too much. So these ideas about what's kind of unhealthy. And I'm also thinking with regard to, you know, what we've been talking about with food and race, right? And just, you know, how so much of the kind of fear of foreign foods, you know, has to do with this kind of idea of foreign contamination, right? This idea that kind of bringing in foreign substances is not actually conducive to the health, you know, a healthy early modern English or early modern European body, precisely because those foods are not native. And then obviously there are a lot of contradictions there. You know, we're seeing so many ingredients that are being used. And I think that's sort of a really kind of interesting area to kind of think about. What are the kind of guidelines and criteria that are determining certain foods as being forbidden, being unhealthy? And just to kind of toss in Mummy one last time, you know, that was kind of an interesting thing because from some of the texts that I've looked at, it seems like there was a distinction being made between true mummy and false mummy, with this idea that true mummy was coming from, you know, embalmed bodies from these from abroad, versus a kind of false or counterfeit mummy being processed from local graves, right, or executed criminals. And so that seems to indicate that this idea that the foreign body being used for mummy was actually more efficacious, and that kind of seems to go against that idea of the foreign being kind of poisonous or contaminating.
Hello, I'm back. Okay, so to draw things to a close, I'd like to thank our scholars for their insights during this incredibly rich, wonderful conversation, which will help researchers and teachers at all levels and in all kinds of spaces trace the intersections between food and race. A special thanks also goes to the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation for their support of this series. And I would like to thank our audience and the lively Twitter and chat feeds to which they've contributed. We hope that many of you will be able to join us on November 19th, when we will be joined by Urvashi Chakravarti of the University of Toronto and Marissa Fuentes of Rutgers University for a session on race and the archive. Further details on this and other upcoming critical race conversations may be found on the Folger Institute's webpage soon. With the Folger Shakespeare Library, also ask for your continuing support of our work with so many audiences, from K-12 educators and their students who are served by the Folger Education Division, to fellowships and advanced programming for graduate students and faculty run by the Folger Institute, to the award-winning productions of the Folger Theater. If you are in a position to contribute, we will be grateful. Our institution was founded on philanthropy, and your philanthropy will help us to continue to support groundbreaking research and to share it with a wider and more inclusive audience, just as we did today. And now back to Jennifer Gitanjali for the final word.
Thank you so much. Just to say that we look forward to continuing the conversation in whatever forms, and if there were questions that did get answered, you know where to find us to continue this conversation.
Right, absolutely. We're so grateful for these really generative questions. And, you know, I think what's really exciting about it as we come to a close here is to think about, again, how these can be prompts for future directions in studies across food and race. And so we look forward to continuing these conversations with you all. So thank you.